Hey team, Andre from High Performance Academy here, and welcome to another one of our webinars. Today we're going to be going through some of the intricacies of setting up idle speed control. Specifically, we are going to be using the Megasquirt MS3 Pro ECU on this Mazda MX-5 or Mazda Miata if you're from the US market. And this, in my opinion, is one of those subtle aspects that so many tuners just don't bother getting right. And particularly for a daily driven car, it really can make a massive difference. It's always nice if you've got a car that you can basically reach in the window, regardless whether it's the middle of winter or the middle of summer, turn the key and it will start and idle without you needing to nurse it with your foot on the throttle. Before we get into that though, just covering off a few things that have been happening here over the last week or so. One of the ones that we're really excited to mention is we are running another one of our giveaways, and I'm pretty confident this one is going to be really popular. We've partnered with Haltech and we're giving away one of their brand new Haltech Nexus R5 ECUs plus our suite of training courses. If you've been living under a rock, the Nexus was announced probably around about 18 months ago now at PRI back in 2019, back when the world was allowed to travel. And that was pre-release. It wasn't actually available for public consumption until around about this time, maybe a little bit later last year. One of the novel aspects with the Nexus R5, which when you look at it now really just makes perfect sense, is that they have incorporated a ECU, and this is an iteration beyond their existing Elite Series ECUs. They've added a lot more technology into the ECU, a lot more functionality into the ECU. They've also incorporated a full power distribution module, power management unit, depending on how you want to refer to that. So this is basically a complete vehicle electronics control package. You can control all of your power distribution to your various circuits throughout the car, as well as your engine management, do it all from the one place. So it really neatens up your installation and your solution for the electronic side of things. Now, on top of that, we are also giving away our suite of tuning courses so that you're going to know exactly what to do with that Haltech Nexus R5 if you do happen to be the lucky winner. Total price package there is somewhere in the vicinity of about $5,000. This is probably one of our biggest prizes that we have given away. So on my laptop screen at the moment, this is the little page you'll come through to if you click the link that the team will drop into the comments. We've got 22 days left to get your name into that draw. Regardless where you are in the world, we'll ship it to your door free of charge. It doesn't matter where you're personally located. Don't worry, you won't miss out. When you do get your name into the draw, there are also a few other tasks that you can complete that will give you a few extra entries, giving you a little bit more chance of winning that epic prize. So 22 days left. Make sure that you get your name into the draw. Now, for those of you who have been watching over the last few of our webinars, I have kind of previewed an upcoming course that I was working on for the last few months. And this is one that I know is going to be helpful to a lot of tuners out there. This is the topic of continuous variable cam control tuning. Now, it's something that at the start of my career, we were seeing a lot of ECUs that didn't actually have the ability to control continuously variable cam control. Just to take one step back for those who aren't aware of what I'm talking about. With that technology, it allows us the ability to advance or retard the camshaft while the engine's actually operating. So we can map the camshaft opening and optimize it relative to engine load and engine RPM. And as I mentioned at the time, a lot of ECUs didn't have this technology available to control the variable cam position. And we saw a few of the performance engines start to come out that incorporated variable valve timing technology. And at the time, I remember distinctly a number of the name brand ECUs basically played down the technology, that it really wasn't that valuable and really was mainly around emissions. So if we just jump over to my laptop screen, this is just a screenshot that I actually took as part of this course, and this is from our turbocharged Toyota 86. So I've got a red and a blue run here. This is actually power and torque, and what we can see is, first of all, if we go over to the right hand side, the actual peak power and torque values here are relatively similar. This is where I've only been varying the intake cam, and you can see up the top here, we've actually mentioned what we've got here. So the blue run is with the intake cam at the zero advanced position. So this is its natural position, which generally will favor high RPM performance. The red run there is with the cam timing tuned. And just this particular point that I have listed here, we can see we've gone from 143 horsepower up to 205 horsepower, almost 206 horsepower, just by optimizing the cam timing on the intake cam. So around about 60 horsepower gain. A lot of this has come by improving the turbo boost response. So personally, that for me, it's no joke. This is a real technology that is incredibly valuable. It makes a massive difference. And if you are running a variable valve timing engine and you had an ECU that wasn't capable of controlling it, understandably, you're leaving a lot of potential power and torque on the table. So what we've done is we've created this course because the next obvious question is, how do we actually go about optimizing the cam timing? And if you aren't really aware of the process behind this, then it can be pretty daunting. It can be confusing. And it's also very easy to end up getting results that actually don't do justice to the possible performance that you can get out of it. So given that we know that this is something that a lot of people struggle with, we have created our variable cam timing course. So I'm just going to take you through this, and we'll head over to my laptop screen. I'll just show you where you can find it. It literally was launched about an hour ago. So you go to hpacademy.com and click on our courses. And if you scroll right down to the bottom under advanced tuning topics, we have our variable cam tuning course. It is currently available for $149. If we click find out more, I'll just take you through what is included. And you can do this obviously in your leisure. You can watch a video that explains it in a bit more detail than I'm going to do here. And if we come down and click on view curriculum, this will take you through the modules. I'll just expand these all out. So we start with the fundamentals of cam control. And while this is focused primarily on continuously variable cam control, I also do cover in this course some of the other techniques such as switch cam control. We liken this to the system that Honda used with their VTEC, Nissan with VVL, and also some of the switch cam advanced control functions from the likes of Nissan with their variable cam timing, which is not where it's continuously variable. The intake cam is just swung between two maximum and minimum limits. Toyota also incorporated this on the blacktop Toyota 4AGE. So you'll find out what the difference between fixed versus variable cam timing is. We talk about what is inside one of the continuously variable cam control actuators. Then for those who are running a fixed cam engine, we talk about vernier cam gears, how those work. We talk about switched versus continuous variable cam control. Inlet versus exhaust cam. So you will notice that, particularly at the start of the development of this technology, continuously variable cam control was normally only applied to the intake valve or intake cam. And the reason for this is that the engine performance is much more sensitive to intake cam timing changes. There are some advantages with having it on both cams, which is why we see now it's quite popular on both cams, on your engine. Then we'll talk about our system requirements, the hardware, the inputs and outputs that are required, the ECU control systems, and some of the considerations around the oil that you're running, as well as aftermarket cams. We dive into some of the different ECU control strategies that are available here. Everyone's got their own idea, particularly in the OE tuning world. So I should point out this course, not solely for those who are interested in learning about tuning and aftermarket standalone. We also cover the mainstream factory systems as well, how those work. The other aspect is that PID control, this is the backbone of continuously variable cam control tuning. And if we don't get this right, this is the closed loop system that will define how the system will respond if we're targeting a certain cam angle and we're not quite there. So if we don't have this right, the whole tuning is going to be flawed. So we talk in depth about what PID is. We'll give you a practical analogy, and then we actually give you a real demonstration on the dyno, showing the process of dialing in the PID gains to get really crisp, stable control. This is something that I I know a lot of tuners get put off by, but it's actually really, really easy and quick to do with cam control because the system is so easy to manipulate and get consistent and repeatable results. We then look at some of the practical skills here, such as ECU configuration, PID optimization, optimizing our inlet cam timing, optimizing dual variable cam control, part cam time, part throttle cam timing, as well as a really important one here, particularly as the world moves on, the effect of cam timing on our emissions. Now, I know in the aftermarket tuning world, we're generally looking for power over emissions, but as emission standards become more and more stringent, this is something you are going to have to think about. And we show a live demonstration on the dyno how the cam timing affects, and specifically in that example, our oxides of nitrogen or NOx emissions. We also include a simple HPA five-step tuning process here, which covers the process you can apply irrespective of essentially what style of cam control you are using. So be it you're tuning a VTEC style system with a simple switch cam control, or you're tuning dual variable cam control, it doesn't matter there. Now, we do have a couple of worked examples that are in this. They're not in there at the moment, but they will be within the next 24 hours, covering the tuning process on a continuously variable cam control engine, specifically our Subaru STI fitted with the Haltech Elite ECU. So if you're interested in that course, go and check it out. Again, you'll find it at hpacademy.com/courses. Now, just a quick update as well on our SR86. I did mention a couple of weeks ago we were back up and running. And one of the reasons we wanted that up and running is that we actually used the SR86 for a couple of the topics in the cam control course. Our SR86 is fitted with an SR20 with a VVL cylinder head from Nissan. So that incorporates the switch cam mechanism, much like Honda's VTEC. So I use that to demonstrate how to optimize switch cam timing. But we've also fitted vernier adjustable cam gears to that, so we actually go through a full worked example on how to optimize the location or the timing on vernier adjustable cam gears, which is common on older fixed cam engines. Now, one of the problems we'd had with the SR20, and it's a strange problem, but a problem nonetheless, is that it wanted to rev too high. And we were originally using a set of Calford cams, and we weren't trying to make power at 9,000 RPM, but that's basically exactly what they did. And this is not really something we wanted for an engine that's going to be used for endurance racing. And we wanted to basically pull back the RPM range that we were using. And ideally, we wanted to bolster the mid-range performance from the GTX 3076 Gen 2 Turbo. So we head off to the laptop screen again. We fitted, instead of the Calford cams, a set of factory Nissan P12 Primera cams. And we've got the overlay here, and it hasn't quite given me the exact results I wanted, but it's a good comparison anyway. So in the red run here, what we have is the old Calford cams, the last time we had the engine running. And I've just used this. This wasn't the maximum amount of power we ended up with, but I've used it as a good comparison at the same boost pressure. So both of these runs were made at 15 PSI, let's call it one bar, if you like to work in metric. So it's a nice comparison there. Unfortunately, while I do have boost down the bottom, we don't actually have that logged for our red run, which is a little bit of a shame. However, what we can see at the particular point that I've highlighted here, 4,800 RPM, we've gone from 222 wheel horsepower to 274 wheel horsepower. So a pretty handy 50 horsepower gain through the mid-range here. Despite that, you can actually see that right up at 7,600 RPM here, we actually haven't really given away a lot. Peak power with our P12 cams at 7,600 RPM ended up being 457 horsepower. I think we ended up with 460, but we're splitting hairs there, versus 506 with the Calford cams. Now, a lot of this is, you can see, the Calford cams we were revving out to, in this case, 8,700 RPM. Interestingly, even with the P12 cams at 7,600 RPM, the power and, more importantly, the torque are actually still climbing. So if I'd actually continued that out to 85, 8,700, I think we'd have probably seen a similar trend, although I'd sort of be expecting that this would end up sort of tapering off a little bit like this. So the power band's still really a little bit higher than I'd wanted, but definitely an improvement. While it's not the perfect solution at the moment, what we are going to do is simply cap the maximum RPM at 7600 RPM, at least for endurance racing. Once we've proven the whole package, we may bump the RPM limit for some sprint races up to maybe 8 or maybe even 8,500 RPM. But ultimately, this is only at 15 PSI. If we want more power, it's going to be as simple as adding more boost. But for the time being, I think 460 wheel horsepower is going to be more than adequate for the car. If everything goes well, and we are chasing a few gremlins with the ABS system at the moment, if all goes well, we may actually be having the opportunity to shake the car down this week and even compete in a sprint race this weekend. So we'll see how that all goes. All right, just heading back to my notes for a second, and I have been mentioning this for the last few webinars, but we're pretty excited about it, so I'm going to keep mentioning it. We've got a podcast, so if you have not been following and this is news to you, if we head over to my laptop screen, if you go to hpatechtalk.com, you'll come through to this page and they'll give you access to basically all of our webinars, and you've got the ability to basically download those on any of your usual places where you would listen to podcasts. So we'd love it if you go along and subscribe. Also, leave us a review if you like what you're hearing. That's going to be great to improve our visibility, and it will allow us then to improve and bring out more podcasts as well. Right, I just want to mention our latest YouTube video, and this is actually from about 12 months ago now. This was filmed at the Sydney Jamboree, which unfortunately ended up getting rained out. This was the last time we were allowed to leave the country, just before New Zealand and Australia went into our respective COVID lockdowns. This is an XW Ford Falcon, and it's not like most XW Falcons because it's running a 4,000 horsepower Proline twin turbo V8. It's making that 4,000 horsepower at about 45 PSI. And one of the interesting things with this car is it's not just a case of making power. It's easy to make power with a large cube V8 with modern turbo technology on methanol fuel. But getting that to the ground through a 275 drag radio is the challenging part. So we dive into what's involved in getting the power to the ground, tuning that, and most importantly, an area that is so often overlooked. When we look at all these videos online about these huge power drag engines, we dive into what's actually involved with maintaining one of these engines and keeping it alive, because of course it's not just a case of going and running laps at the drag strip. If you want to keep an engine like this in one piece, it does require a lot of attention. So if you're interested, go check that out on our YouTube channel. While you're there, subscribe. If you enjoyed that video, give us a thumbs up. And also, if you've got any questions on it, please feel free to ask in the comments. We try our very best to answer as many questions as we can. Now, on the same note as well, just going through our social media, I just wanted to jump across to our Instagram. And this is an Instagram we put up recently, which is an engine that I was involved in the tuning of quite a while ago, which is a New Zealand designed and built Synergy V8. This uses a pair of motorcycle cylinder heads on a CNC machined block. Nothing particularly unusual. We've seen this with the Hayabusa based V8s and the likes of the radical V8s as well for a fair while, the RPE V8, which we've got a YouTube video on as well. But the interesting thing here is not so much the engine as the inlet trumpets, and this on face value might look a little bit odd. What we've got here is different length intake trumpets, and this is actually pretty commonplace in the sport motorbike world. And the idea here, obviously, is that with different length inlet trumpets, we're going to be optimizing the cylinder full or volumetric efficiency at different RPM ranges. Now, that might seem like a weird idea, but with some of these engines, the power delivery and the torque can be very, very peaky. And so by going with a split length inlet trumpet like this, basically it smooths out that torque curve. And particularly on a sport bike, this can make the world of difference in terms of drivability. Rideability, maybe you call it that. I'm not too sure. So obviously one of the implications with this is because we're going to have different volumetric efficiency cylinder to cylinder based on the inlet trumpet length, this does affect our tuning strategy as well. In the perfect world there, we'd really want the likes of individual cylinder lambda so we can see exactly what's going on. But an interesting technique nonetheless. Obviously, we've seen vehicles over the years in the motorsport world which have used continuously variable length inlet trumpets. So there, they can optimize length of the trumpets based basically to improve the torque curve and the usable rev range. Alrighty, we're going a bit long here, so I will finish up, but I will finish up just by reminding you that giveaway for the Haltech Nexus R5, 22 days left. Again, there's a link in the comments that you can follow to get your name into the draw. Don't miss out, it is a great giveaway, $5,000 worth of value right there, so don't miss out on that. Give me a few moments here and we'll get started with today's webinar.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.